Belisarius Cawl is one of the key new characters in the war-torn future of the 41st millennium. The model is absolutely packed with detail and really embodies the sheer madness of the Adeptus Mechanicus. Now, at first glance, it can look quite complex to paint, but it's not actually that difficult, and we're going to show you the entire process from start to finish. So, grab your paints and let's get to it. Before we start painting, I just want to quickly point out to you the various sub-assemblies I've made this miniature in, and I recommend you do the same because doing so will make painting it so much easier, especially to get to all that fine detail. What we've got are all of the many, many legs, then we've got his upper body, and we've also got the power axe separate as well. And I've also undercoated them using lead belcher spray. I've only used lead belcher for this because not only does it undercoat the miniature, but it means that first step is done straight away, and now we can start painting in some finer details. So the first colour we're going to apply by brush is Retributor Armour, and as always, give all your paints a good shake before you use each one, especially with your metallics. Now the gold details are quite intricate and they're all over the miniature, so I'm going to start out with a medium layer brush, but it's a good idea to have a small layer brush on hand for doing the smaller ones. Now throughout this video I'm going to be making use of a palette to control my paints, and I really recommend you do the same. Doing so means you can put a little dollop like that on there, then you can add a small amount of water to the mix. Now in doing so, thins your paint down so it just applies smoother and dries smoother. You'll find it much easier to apply the paints if you do this. Make sure you don't have too much on your brush, and when you're ready, all you've got to do is start picking out the gold details. I'm going to start on the legs here on this trim, just being as neat as I can as I follow them round. These gold details are all over the place, so I do recommend you use your box art to help guide you through which bits to paint, and you will need to apply two thin coats of this colour as well. I finished applying the Retributor Armour to this sub-assembly, and as you can see, I've applied it to all three of them as well, and now ready to start shading all these metallics. Now to do this, I'm going to use Agrax Earth Shade, and I'm going to be applying it with a medium shade brush, and it's worth noting at this point there will be some details that you don't need to shade, things like the robes and stuff, but that provides really useful areas where you can hold the components whilst you're applying the shade, if you're finding it a bit tricky to find somewhere where you don't need to put paint, for example. So what you need to do is just build up a good puddle of this on your palette, and when you're ready, all you need to do is start applying it to the metallics. So I'm going to start on this component once again, applying it on the back just here. Like I said, you don't have to worry about getting it on any of the robes at this point. Just make sure you get all the metallic parts that you want to keep metallic. Once the shade's completely dry, you're then ready to move on to highlighting all of the gold. And for this, we're going to use Liberator Gold, applied with a small airbrush once more. And what we're looking to do here is what's called an edge highlight. So to do it, what you do is just put some of the paint onto your palette and then thin it down as always. But this time, what you need to do is use the palette to control the paint to bring the bristles to a nice tip. And a good way to do that is to just drag it along and twist it there like that. And all you're looking to do is paint a line of this colour along all the sharpest edges of these gold details. So for example, on this part just back here, I'm just going to angle the brush just so I catch that edge. I get a nice neat line running around that detail there like that. And the same is true on all these ledges, just follow them all the way around. For these slightly rounded parts though on this trim, all you have to do is just angle your brush so the side of the bristles are catching it. Just paint a single line just running along each one there like that. Once you've finished highlighting that gold, we're then ready to finish off highlighting all the metallics by dry brushing them all using Necron Compound. Now to dry brush, what you need is a small dry brush and a piece of tissue, and all you do is just get some of the paint on the end of your brush, and then on the tissue, just use it to start working the paint in amongst the bristles and getting rid of the excess too. You want a very small amount of paint left on your brush before you start to apply it, so really work it away there like that. And when you're ready, all you've got to do is very lightly start drawing your brush back and forth across the detail on your miniature. So for example, on this little claw we've got down here, if I just lightly brush across like that, you can see the paint catches the edges and gives us a really nice highlight. Now, a word of caution when you're doing this, be aware that some of the parts in this miniature are very fragile, so just be very gentle as you do this so that you don't break any parts off as you apply it. Once you've finished applying that dry brush, all the metallic colours are complete, and now we can start adding some more colours by using some base paints. So, we're going to begin with Mephiston Red, and this will be to paint all the robes, and then we'll use Rakar Flesh for all the turnbacks on the robes. Finally, we're going to use Corn Red, and this is for all the armoured parts that you want to be red. So, starting with Mephiston Red, I'm going to be starting with my medium layer brush here, and as always, going to make use of the palette to get the paint ready by thinning it down with a small amount of water. And well, for this, what you're looking to do is to work around all the intricate details and the metallics that we've done already so far. So, it's a good idea to have a whole variety of different sizes here. A small layer brush, I think, really is vital at this stage too. But for the legs, it's quite straightforward here. All you're looking to do is to paint in the robes here. You will need two thin coats to get good solid coverage here, but as you're doing the robes, just watch out for these little tears. Or we've got some cables showing through. Just be careful around those details. And if in doubt, just check out the box art for reference. Once you've finished base coating Mephiston Red, the next colour you need is Rakar Flesh. Now for this example, I'm switching over to the arm here because what we're looking for is any turnbacks, for example, just here on the sleeve, and also any parts of the robe where you can see the inside of it too. So you'll once again need two thin coats, but just take your time being as neat as you can on this part. I've finished applying the Rakarth flesh to all the turnbacks, and also if you look carefully on the legs, you can see I've painted some on the inside folds of the robes as well. I'm now ready to move on to corn red, and this is for all the armoured red parts. So this little creepy crawling device we've got out the front here, I'm going to paint all the armoured parts of this with this colour, with again two thin coats. With those three base colours applied, the model's taken a massive jump forward, and now we're ready to start shading them. And for all three, we're going to use Agraxer shade, applied first of all with a medium shade brush, but this time we're going to be much more controlled about where exactly we're putting this shade. So it's a good idea to have a variety of different sizes on hand. Definitely have a small layer on hand, because you will need that for some of the intricate detail around the miniature's face. So once you've got some shade on your palette, a good puddle there, you can control exactly how much you have in a brush, and all you've got to do is start painting this over all three of those colours we just added. So I'm going to start on the robes just here, being careful whenever I get close to those silver parts. So you want to avoid getting any of this onto the silver and gold. Once the shade's completely dry, we're ready to finish off all these colours, and we're going to first of all focus on finishing the red parts. So for this, we're going to go back to Mephiston Red first of all, and then we're going to layer it using Evelson Scarlet. Now after that, we're going to start highlighting, first of all with Wild Rider Red, and if you want to, you can then do an extra highlight of Fire Dragon Bright. But starting with Mephiston Red, I'm going to use my medium layer brush once more, and this time we just need to be a little bit more controlled about how we apply it. So, as always, use the palette to get your paint ready, and this time bring those bristles to a nice tip on your palette. And when you're ready, what you're looking to do is to paint this onto the robes, but avoid the recessed areas where the shade is settled. So, for example, on these folds I've got here, I'm going to paint some on this side here, and then avoid that recessed part in the middle, and pick up the colour again on the other side there, like that. Next we're going to apply a layer of Evelson Scarlet, following mostly the same method we did previously. So still a smooth coat on these robes, only this time you don't want to go all the way down to the recess. What we want is to have Evelson Scarlet, then some Mephiston Red showing in there, and then the shade of Mephiston Red in the very deepest part of the robe there, like that, to get a nice transition between the colours. Now there's also another part to do with Evelson Scarlet, and that's to highlight all the red armoured parts. And for this you just need to switch to a small layer brush. What we're looking to do here is apply an edge highlight onto all the sharpest edges of these details. Next we're on to Evelson Scarlet, and this is just to highlight the robes. For this you're looking to pick out the very tops of these folds. So this line is running along here, I'm just going to follow it along, picking it out with a fine line all the way down like that. Now whenever you encounter tears, be sure to go all the way around these two, and when you get to the bottom of the robe, be sure to follow all the way around the hem as well. And then if you want to, you can add an extra fine highlight using Fire Dragon Bright. And if you choose to do this, just focus it on the very sharpest parts of the fabric, just a small area like this, applied with an extra small artificer layer brush. And there we are, the red robes are now complete, and we can move on to painting all the cream coloured parts, so the inside of the robe and the turnback too. And for all of this, all we need is a shabty bone, and then we're going to highlight with Screaming Skull. But first of all, with the shabty bone, I'm going to go for a small layer brush now, and we're looking to do a very smooth thin layer of this. So as always, make use of your palette to get your paint ready. And once it's thin, all we've got to do is start applying it to these turnbacks. So I'm going to go for the one on the sleeve just here. And what I'm looking to do is apply a layer over most of this, but any creases that you spot, just leave those darker. So for example, at the top here, we've just got a very slight one, so I'm just going to leave that a bit darker there like that. And I will be applying two thin coats on the flatter areas. And then heart these parts using Screaming Skull by applying the colour all along the edges of these details. And with that, we've now completed all the paler parts of the robe, and well, the model's looking mostly done, but we still have a load of smaller details yet to paint, and we're going to start running through those now. Now the first one's going to be the book that Cawl's standing on, specifically the pages, and for this we're going to base coat with Rakarth flesh, and then we're going to paint in the bookmark using corn red. Then we'll shade all these colours with Agraxer shade, and then finish off the pages with Pallid Witch flesh, and the bookmark with Evelson Scarlet. So starting then with Rakarth flesh, I'm going for my medium layer brush for this one, and once you've got your paint ready, it's just a matter of base coating this detail in. As always at this point, just be careful, because now we've got lots of parts finished and you just have to work around those. For the book, the kind of thing we've got to be aware of is the little crab thing at the front here, so just be really careful avoiding that as you apply this colour, and you will need two thin coats. Then base coat the bookmark using corn red, this time with a small layer brush. With those colours now base coated, apply a coat of Agraxer shade over both of them. Once the shade's completely dry, we're now ready to highlight the pages using Pallid Witch flesh. And then highlight the bookmark using Evelson Scarlet. With the pages and the bookmark now done, we need to paint the actual book cover itself. And also, we're going to be painting a couple of other details at the same time because all these parts are going to be black. And for this, we just need a Baden black for the base coat, and then we're going to highlight using Eschen Grey. So starting with the Baden black, I'm going to begin with a medium layer brush this time. And these details are, well, aside from the book cover, it's things like cables and pipes and all that kind of thing. So once your paint is ready, all you've got to do is base coat these details. And I'm going to start on the cable that's just up here being held up by the servo skull. So you just need a good coat of black on this, so I do recommend applying two thin coats. With all that black base coated, we're now ready to highlight it with Eschen Grey. Now for the book, what you want to do is apply an edge highlight just around all the edges of it, just as neatly as possible. For these smoother cables, what you want to do is paint a line running along towards the top of it. So just a smooth line along there just to pick out that highlight. But as for the ridged cables, for these it's a little bit different. Just very lightly run your brush across them so it only catches that raised detail. So it's almost like dry brushing doing these ones. And once you've finished applying the Eschen Grey, the highlight for the black is complete, and now we can start painting the next small detail. And this is going to be for all the bones. So we've got two servo skulls to paint, but also there's a skull on top of his cane, so we need to paint that too. And all these are going to use Zandri dust as a base coat, and then we'll shade over that with Agraxer shade. After that, we'll layer with a Shabti bone to brighten the bone back up again, then finish off with a highlight of Screaming Skull. So starting in with Zandri dust, I'm going to begin with my medium layer brush for this one. And well, what you want here is lots of control because we need to paint around a lot of technology on these. So make sure your paint's nice and thin and ready. And all you got to do is start applying this base color to the bone. Now we'll be applying two thin coats to this well. And like I said, both of them, I'm going to be really careful not to get any of this on the silver. Next, shade over all the bone using Agraxer shade, still with your medium layer brush. Once the shade's completely dry, we're ready to add a layer of a Shabti bone to the bone. Now for this, what you want to do is use a small layer brush and you want to paint it across all the bone, just avoiding the recessed areas where the shade has settled the most. And then finish off with a highlight of Screaming Skull, following along all the sharpest details of the bone. With the bone now complete, we're ready to move on to the next small detail, and this is going to be called skin, or what's left of it anyway. And for this, we're going to start out with a base coat of Rakar flesh, then shade over it with a Thonian camo shade. After that, we'll go back to Rakar flesh to neaten it up, and then we'll highlight with Pallid Witch flesh. So starting in with Rakar flesh, I'm going straight to my small layer brush this time, and it's a, well, an essential size brush for this sort of detail, really, because a lot of this skin's very tricky to get to, so you must take your time with this step. Once your paint's ready, all you've got to do is start picking out these areas, and I'm going to start on his hand and his arm just here, being really careful around all those metallic details that are embedded into his skin, and you will need two thin coats of this colour. And once that base coat's applied, shade over all the skin with a Thonian camo shade. Once the shade's completely dry, we're going back to Rakar flesh, but this time applying it like a layer. So what you want to do is just avoid the recessed areas where the shade has settled. And then finish off the skin with a highlight of Pallid Witch flesh, using this to pick out all the sharper details, for example, things like the knuckles. And there we are, all the horrible rotting skin is complete, and we're on to the next feature. And this one's optional, really. It's the green cables that appear around him. And if you want to do these, what you need is Caliban green for the base coat, and then we'll shade the cables with a small amount of Norn oil. After that, we'll layer them using Warpstone glow, and then we'll finish with a very fine highlight of Moot green. So starting with Caliban green, I'm going straight to my small airbrush for this one. And well, these cables are scattered all over the miniature. I recommend use box art to help finding them, but like I said, it's optional whether you do these or not. Once your paint's ready, all you got to do is start picking them out, and I'm going to begin with this one that's on the legs just back here, and you want to get a good even base coat on these details, so I do recommend applying two thin coats. Next, paint some Norn oil into any recessed detail on the cables. In the case of this example, we're looking at a small amount on either end. Now we're ready to brighten up the cables by applying Warpstone glow to them, and for this what you want to do is do a fairly broad highlight across the top half of them, so about halfway down either side of the cable. And finally, if you want to take this detail just a bit further, apply a fine highlight of Moot green as a line just across the very top of the cable. With the green cables complete, we're now ready to move on to the next detail. And this next detail is actually also green. It's the screen of the data pad that's on one of Belisarius' right arms. And for this, we're going to once again start with a base coat of Caliban green. And then we're going to apply some Warpstone glow to highlight it, then a small amount of Moot green, and then finish off with a dot of white scar. So starting on with Caliban Green, I'm back to my small airbrush once more, and for this what you're looking to do is to, well, base coat the entirety of the screen. And it's for this detail really that we kept that whole right arm separate with the axe, because getting to this is really difficult if that's still glued on. The detail we're looking at specifically is this one just here, and all you've got to do is apply the screen all over it, being as neat as you can around the edges. Next, paint a line of warpstone glow along the right hand side of the screen, and also a line along the bottom of it as well. Next, repeat this process, but this time using moot green, and this time just focus the line a little bit more towards that bottom right corner. And finally, complete the screen with a dot of white scar in the opposite corner. And there we have the completed screen effect. Now, if you wanted to, you could go a little bit further and apply a coat of Ardcoat Gloss Varnish over the top of it to give it a glassy sheen. But whether you do or not, of course, is entirely up to you. Because now we're going to move on to painting all the glowing blue electronic parts. And for this, we're going to start with a base coat of Calidor Sky, then we're going to layer over that with Baharoth Blue and finish off with a highlight of White Scar. So starting with Calidor Sky, I'm starting off with my medium layer brush for this. You might want to have a small airbrush on hand though, because these details do vary quite a lot. As well as painting all the electricity, we're looking at painting all the eye lenses too, following the same colours and same method. So once your paint is ready, all you've got to do is start base coating these parts. And I'm going to begin with this little jar that we've got on the top of Belisarius's back, just here. You want to be as neat as possible around this detail, applying two thin coats, and if you're not sure which bits to pick out, then just have a good look at the box art. Next, apply a layer of Baharoth Blue over the blue areas, and you will need two thin coats once again, and the application is very slightly different on the cores of this gun as it is from on these parts here. You still want to leave a bit of the blue showing at the very base of them, but as for the cores of the gun, what you're looking to do instead is see, well, you can see how the whole area has been base coated. Instead, just apply this colour to the raised areas on these coils. And finally, highlight these blue details with white scar. Now for these jars, all you've got to do is just paint a little highlight just along the crest of the curve at the top of them there like that. But for the lenses, just put a little dot of white in the very centre of each one, just a small amount there like that. And as for the coils on the gun down here, what I'm going to do here is apply an edge highlight to each of these coils. And there we are, all that blue lightning effect is complete, and actually we've almost finished the miniature. There's only one other detail left to paint, and this one is optional. This is the classic Adeptus Mechanicus symbol, that gear tooth pattern that appears around the hood of the miniature. Now if you want to do this, what you need is Rakarth flesh, and then we're going to layer over that with Pallid Witch flesh. And this will be freehanding, so definitely go for a small airbrush. So starting with Rakarth flesh, what you need to do to make this easier for yourself is thin this paint down more than you normally would. Think of this first coat of the base coat as just a guide for the overall pattern. So you're just blocking it in, really. So the kind of consistency you're looking for is kind of like that. But make sure you've got that good tip on your brush. And when you're ready, what you're looking to do is just start painting this pattern as neatly as you can. The best way I find to do this is to start with a line just running along the edge of the cloak. So a little distance, just following along a vertical line going like that. And just work this all the way around the front of the hood and then gradually widen it out until you're happy with it. Now, once you've got that established, you just got to start painting in the actual teeth, and this is the trickier part. For this, you just need to go a little bit further out, so I'll start on this one on the top here. And then, once you've done that, just neaten up either side as neatly as you can. If you do make any mistakes, just go back to your register and neaten that back up. You just got to take your time and see, working your way around like this. And once you're happy with your pattern, all you need to do is trace over it with Pallid Witch Flesh to complete it. Now, once done this, all that remains is to make the final assembly of your miniature. And I do recommend you do this using super glue and not plastic glue. And then after that, you just have to base it. And as always, I recommend you base your miniature in the same way as the rest of your army. The final assembly's been made and the base has been completed, and with that, Belisarius Cawl is finished. An absolutely fantastic miniature and a truly crazy one as well, as befitting such a high-ranking member of the Adeptus Mechanicus. So when you're painting this miniature, I really recommend you do sub-assemblies just like how we did, because if you do, you'll find painting it is so much easier to get all that detail. If you build the entire thing, it becomes really, really tricky, so sub-assemblies are definitely the way to go. Now when you're dry brushing with Necron Compound, remember to only apply a small amount at once and just softly build up that dry brush so you get a nice soft smooth metal on the flatter panels. And finally, when you're making your final assembly, definitely use super glue. Don't use plastic glue, because if you get that on some paint, it'll melt it and it can ruin your miniature. So definitely use super glue for that. And there you go. Now we really hope you guys have found this one interesting and that you've learned a lot from it as well. We'll see you all again very soon. If you enjoyed that video and you'd like to see more, then why not subscribe to Warhammer TV? It's crammed with content, including loads of other tutorials. And in fact, if you'd like to watch another tutorial right now, why not click one of the links below?